So B is the correct answer, as customs examiners claim. The only way they could do that is by taking by going through the invoice value, which includes non-dutiable charges. However, as we discussed before, the non-dutiable charges can be assessed, but usually they are not assessed because they are not part of the statutory provision under for the MPF assessment, because such as insurance of rates, such as customs broker charges, they are not part of the dutiable charges and not part of the transaction value, which is signified by a total entered value, which is the value that you put on 7501 as a dutiable value, and for which the merchandise processing fee and harbor maintenance fee, if it is applicable, is being assessed. So provided that we read and we do not have this situation with the NDC claim, and provided that customs examiners are not using this non-dutiable charges trick on us, it would be natural, at least for me, to go with 185, not 187 presumption. So, on the exam, I know it will take some time, but it will not take too much time for you to realize what's going on. So, if you were to substitute the, you really need to substitute two things. Right. So here, instead of this value, you will take 185, right? So 185 portion would be affected over here. So if you replace 187 with 185,000, right? Then your percentage would change to something like 6216. Again, rounding to the nearest 4. 6216%. All right. And of course, here you would still have 485. Because if you multiply 185 by this number, the amount would still be over 485. It would be, so 185,000 times 0.003464 equals 64084. So it would be 640,84, which is still more than 485, so 485 stays the same, so that part remains untouched. Next, you have this one remains untouched because 485 is the ceiling. So after changing only this equation to getting this particular percentage, what you do is you plug in this percentage here. And so it would be 216216%. Instead of this one, you plug it in here. So of course this will change the number from 102.43 to 103.82. All right, now the closest to 103.82 is 103.47, and this is where you can get a sneak preview what the customs examiners are looking for, because the rounding margin here is just too much. When you see the round, it can be off by a few cents, but when you have a rounding error, so you have 40, even you're off by how much? You have 35 cents. So you are off by 35 cents here. 35 cents when it's that close is too much, right? And because this is too much, this means that this is unacceptable margin of error over here. This is unacceptable under any rounding that you decide to adopt during your calculation. This is the reason why, because 82 is 35 cent margin is unacceptable. This is when you take out this one and you leave 102. Oops, you leave 102. 43 in place. And of course, 102.43 is right on point. If you plug in all your numbers and you figure it out, it's right on point. It is calculated if you keep to the four decimal levels, right? You will see that this figure is coming up right to the exact number. And so pretty much, even if you round it up, because the figure can be higher. Even if you round it to the hundredth, right, to the two decimal points, you still will have 43. And because this is more precise, this is how you know that customs examiners are looking for this particular answer choice. So that's the way we look for. That's the way we can establish the apportionment, and be mindful of this. So even if you're off a little bit, you still need to change just a couple of operations, one at this level and another one at this level, to see that really there is not too much. There is really not too much going on. As far as plugging in numbers. So in other words, you are not losing too much time. As long as, and this is the key, you have the methodology in place. In the outline, my suggestion is to do the proportions. This proportional outline is echoing suggested methodology. So the relevant regulation for this methodology would be section 191.5. So let me go to the Code of Federal Regulations and introduce you to this section. So part 191 deals with drawback in general, and the calculation, right, completion of drawback claims. This is the relevant section, and it has down here the apportionment of merchandise processing fee by each line item, and the way they explain, and they give examples of this, right? So the way they explain this is by taking the ratio value. To me, it's much easier to deal with percentages. So this is one way, this is another way. As long as you stick to the same methodology, I like to do the proportional formulas and in terms of percentages. This is one way of dealing with it through these equations in terms of establishing the ratios, right? Whichever way you prefer, it's up to you. As long as you keep the methodology the same, and as long as you understand the order of operations here. So that's about the merchandise processing fee apportionment. All right, now. So if you want to look at more examples, review them over there. Be careful with non-dutiable charges. And because this came up before, as we saw in October 2015 exam question 52, and be mindful of the order of operations. All right, so now we get to the required documentation. So let me get this out of the way. So one of the things which we need to be familiar with is a set of CBP forms. One form is CBP form 7551, which is a drawback entry. 7552, which is a certificate of manufacturing delivery, reproduced over here. And another form, which is relevant for our drawback discussion, is notice of intent to export or destroy the merchandise. 7553. This form is becoming less relevant after the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act, because we're this form traces the certificate of manufacture and delivery, traces the chain of custody of the product, the transfer. Every time there is a transfer, and transfer is a buzzword here, as we will see, you have to document this. Now, Trade Enforcement, Trade Facilitation Act said, you probably will still be able to use this form, and it is not likely that it will go away, but you will have an option, whereas before you had to use that form, now you can use whatever methodology you keep in the regular course of business. If it establishes the chain of custody, you will be fine. 7553 has to do with notice of intent to export or destroy. It's applicable. The destruction is applicable to all types of drawback. The notice of export is applicable to unused merchandise and rejected, but not manufacturing. And the key thing to remember here is the number of days and to what type of drawback it is applicable. So keep those points in mind as we go through the outline and we discuss those forms. Going back to the table itself, we know that so we have this breakdown. And to file a drawback, of course, this is a must. This is like 7501 for the entry. CBP form 7551 is for the drawback. It takes all relevant information and it starts the process going. This form, chain of custody, as I mentioned, if currently under old rules, if there is a transfer, every time there is a transfer, it is required, because if there is no transfer, the chain of custody is clear. It's within one person's domain. And that person can be the importer of merchandise and the exporter or destroyer at the same time. But if it's more than one person, then you have to document the transfer. 7553, I think please be mindful of this particular line, because it can be useful as you sit on the exam as a good reference tool of all the days that would be applicable for submitting of the form. Of course, there are exceptions. You can apply for an exception of it's called the waiver of the notice of intent to export. Waiver can also be will also be subdivided into the forward-looking waiver, which means that you have to apply and get waiver approval before actual export takes place. And there is also a backward-looking waiver where you can do that after the fact. Nowadays, the after-the-fact waiver is limited only to one-time single use, and it is also discretionary for customs to approve or deny this. So, destruction is applicable to all types of merchandise, all types of drawback, and it is 7 working days rule. Keep in mind, when you speak working day equals business day. And the reason for working day equals is business day, the reason for you to pay attention to that is because throughout the past, customs examiners have been alternating these words during the customs broker exam questions. The first two is applicable to the manufacturing drawback, right? So they are applicable to the manufacturing drawback variations. The export one, right? There is no such requirement of the manufacturing drawback, no such requirement of export notice. Unused merchandise and rejected merchandise is another story. So in this case, both direct identification and substitution variation for unused merchandise, they have two working day requirement for filing, at least two working days, and the export has five working days requirement. Also, I'd like to bring your attention to the waiver discussion in the informed compliance publication. Let me see, I think I have it up. Yeah, right there. So notice of exportation destruction, customs goes into this two working day rule, five working day rule, and also the waivers. So basically that chart represents the snippet of whatever is here. So that's CBP form 7553. So import entry numbers, of course, you have to relate this to the original entry, because there is no drawback. Even substitution has to be tied to the importation, because you are asking for amount of duties paid, 99 duties and fees paid, and without import there would be no duties, correct? So coding sheet required unless it's filed electronically. So more and more of this stuff goes in the online world. Coding sheet is a simple form. Let me see. I think I have it up over here as a sample coding sheet over here. So here's the example which customs GFK office encourages its filers to use. So you have a line item breakdown for the duties, MPF, HMF, and taxes. Taxes, of course, excise taxes are collected by customs on such thing as the spirits, beer, alcohol, and wine, hard liquor, and wine. So it pretty much provides you the line item breakdown and the totals. All right. So coding sheet is just a tool which allows customs to easily review the calculations that are reported on the CBP form 7551, the entry, the drawback entry. And other documents, they are possible because sometimes customs is would like to ask for supporting documentation if they are not satisfied with the basic bare bone application. So they can ask for the entry documents, the commercial invoices. They can ask for, sometimes they can go even further, they request records that would relate to those, to the fact of the importation, by asking for such thing as the timesheet records of the employees who participated in the production of the the merchandise which was originally imported. So if customs feels like there is more questions to ask because the entry for one reason or another looks suspicious, they reserve the right to do that under section 191.52.